Hi, everybody, and welcome to another Livestream Lecture with Jochen Schleese. Today's episode is all about horses can't lie, or do they? All right, so thank you for tuning in. Please let us know where you're tuning in from. If you're watching on Facebook or YouTube, where in the world are you watching this from? We'd love to connect with you guys all over the planet. Please let us know if you have any questions as well. This is a lecture session, so we only have half an hour to chat with Jochen about the topic. So we typically save the questions for our next session, which is the Q&A, but please feel free to also send them to us regardless. And without any further ado, let's welcome Jochen into the session.
Hi, Mary Claire. Thank you very much. It's a great topic these days because, as we know, there is a lot of controversy in the horse world.
And, as always,
yeah. As always, right? Yeah. And we all, or I like to believe that we all love horses, and horses are such a beautiful, beautiful animals because they give us so much more than just a piggyback ride, right? They compassion, warmth, love, and that's why mankind has been so long with horses. I always like the saying, you know, oh, my car has 120 horsepower. Why don't they call it sheep power or bull power? You know, so because we used to have horses, what went us from A to B. One carriage horse, two carriage horse, four carriage horse. And if you look at the Budweiser commercial, that beer wagon has 8 horsepower. So anyway, with further ado, most people do love horses, and most people get really, really involved with horses, not just for show jumping or for Olympic sport, but just to be with the animal. And we have an unbelievable, overwhelming new type of riders. We call them the baby boomers. The baby boomers who start late in horseback riding, people who always loved horses, but they didn't have the time or the money back then. Now, kids are in university, husband is on the golf course, finally I have the time, I start to ride. And with that comes, of course, a lot of people who didn't grow up with horses and don't understand the horses as people who grow up with horses. So we have a lot of people who specialize in horsemanship. Even universities, okay? When you look at the picture I have online right now, you know, that droopiness under the eyeball. You only see part of the horse's head, but you see the eye. And universities now publish paper called Ethogram, how to read the horse's emotion or pain. So can they lie? Can the horse lie? Do they? Well, this is what this webinar is all about. Let's start with our intro first. Okay, click too early. So anyway, here I am. And today's topic, horses can't lie, or do they? So if you look at these three pictures of this horse, I always say, look at the eyes, the ears, the mouth. What do they try to tell us? And this is the big question here. And this is the seminar we choose to put on, because as I said, there's so much more professionals out there who dedicated to help to combine horse and rider and understand each other a little bit more. So if you grow up with a horse and the horse comes charging with you towards you with the ears back, you have a little cautious. If you don't know that sign, you might react too late. So if a horse gets the saddle on and the ears fly back, or that horse is just hates being saddled. And then you forgot your saddle, or your saddle was in repair, and you borrow your friend's saddle, you put your friend's saddle on, and all of a sudden the horse doesn't react at all. I thought the horse hates saddles. So if the horse reacts with one saddle but not with the other, maybe the horse tries to tell us something. Horses are very unique animals, as I was just talking about that. And we always, always looking for the answers. What do they try to tell us? Now, you can ask five horse experts and you'll look at this picture here and you will hear lots of different answers. So if you have people who are specialized in training a horse, or people who specialize in biomechanics or understand the line, we see here a holding line. Okay, that horse holds itself in the flank and whatever sits on top will not help that. So the question we need to ask, why is this horse having a holding line? Furthermore, look at all this in the front. All these lines in the front. This here is a sunken rib cage, or a horse what really stands. Look how he's standing there. Sure, you could say, oh, he was just a moment. Normally he doesn't stand like this. Okay. So, but the lines of the muscle can tell you, okay, what is going on with the horse. So who am I to make comments like this? Just because I'm in the horse world for 44 years in saddle making, or been on horse and with horse over 50 plus years? No, because I'm working with many, 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 many horse experts, such as veterinary professor, biomechanics, and I learned from them to read this line. If you're not an expert and you watch this horse gallop on the treadmill, you can see there's no movement in the lumbar and in the loin. You don't have to be a horse expert to say this horse looks absolutely rigid and sore. You don't have to be an expert to say this looks weird, completely pressed away. Okay, look at the tail carriage. Oh, it's an Arab. They always go like that. No. Okay, so if we have today's science, what applies us with incredible knowledge, like I mentioned earlier, the ethogram. This is Sue Dyson. When I met her in England, she came up with the first ethogram. And ethograms is the, she wrote a paper on the facial expression of the horse's pain. Now, this is my best friend right there. This horse here, he was 1.73 meters tall horse, thoroughbred Hanoverian. I rode with him in the German championship. This is a massive drop fence. He totally over jumped it. Beautiful horse, okay? But I did not listen to his signs. What type of signs, right? He started to look like this horse. The light disappeared out of the eye. They started to lose the spirit. He was not coming running towards me anymore. He was losing it. And then of course I can say, well, because back then I was a bad rider, or I can say, yeah, I had bad training, or I can say, yeah, I had bad saddles. Yeah, I had bad shoeing. I can blame it, whatever. The fact of the matter is, there's a saying when we look at pictures like this. Horses don't lie. Look at the eyes, the ears, the mouth. Or do they? So let's think about nature, okay? Before we jump them over, jump high fences, okay? Let's think about nature. Nature has a horse on the field, on the wide open fields, and the horse walks 20 miles a day, grazes 17 hours, and lives in the herd. And when they move together, they don't speak English or German, they have a body language. And that certain body language is how they communicate, which all of you guys who grew up with horses totally know. And that's kind of what she did, and other universities do. She says, there's certain ways our horses communicate. What does this mean when there's three wrinkles over the nose or over the ear or over the eye and so on forth? Other veterinarians, you know, very accomplished riders like him. He's a German certified trainer. He's then Dr. Gerd Horschmann, become a top veterinarian in Germany and worked at the Olympic Training Center in Germany, says when a horse gets ridden bad, he shows a certain signs. And if the horse shows you a certain sign and you ignore it, okay, they don't do it because they want to say, oh, today is Monday, let's put a show on. And maybe because today is Monday, I don't want to ride, I'm just going to bite them when you girth up. If the horse bites you when you girth up, you might want to check your girth, your saddle pad, or your saddle. Or if you say, oh, he's just so stiff today, I don't know what's wrong with him, I can't bend him to the right side, and you're just jerking on the rein, and you think he's just making it up. Maybe this saddle on this horse, see how it goes to the right, goes to the right? That could be a reason. That could be reason why the horse bends easy to the left. But now you ask him to bend to your right leg, but the saddle tells him to bend around the left leg. So how can the saddle tell anything? Well, let's go back a step. As a rider, my most important aid is not my voice or my whip or my spur or my hands, it's my seat. My seat is my most important aid. And if the saddle sits me strong against the left side of the horse's spine, he's going to bend, he wants to bend away from it. So if he tells me, I don't want to bend there, is he lying because he doesn't feel like it? Or because he feels pressure on that side? Of course, then we will have the nastiness on the withers. And then, of course, the wither cup will atrophy. You know, I found this on a web, on a nice magazine, Holistic Horse. And it was talking about orthopedic shoes for horses. I loved it. It said the primary goals for orthopedic shoes are to provide support, prevent injury, and maintain a functional level of comfort for the horse. And when we talk about orthopedic saddle fit, people are sometimes, what is that? You know, so I'm going to come back to that in a minute. But what I like is orthopedic, if you divide that word in Greek, means to keep it straight. To keep the saddle straight is absolutely important, because if you don't address this issue, it keeps pushing it to one side. And like you see on this horse had a massive left shoulder. So if you don't open the tree on the left side, you can't do it with every saddle. But here at Schleese, we only work with adapt trees, which means we can adapt and fit the saddle to the bigger shoulder without twisting the saddle. You can't do that with a normal wood tree, okay? So we could, of course, at Schleese build saddles for half the price by buying these cheap trees, but then you can't adapt it to the horse, right? So you can't do an orthopedic fit. Because what we need to understand, horses are not even by nature. Sometimes they're grown with a different lumbar. Check this out. The thoracic, the transitional vertebrae, right, makes a big difference how the saddle sits on the horse. Or check this out. The first two ribs, they're not even on this horse. Okay, that means that the horse is very uneven. Or this one here. Look at this upper arm versus this upper arm. This is bone structure. So if somebody tells you, oh, with special lunging and special training my horse, I get the horse straight. How in the world are you re-bending a bone, what is finished, grown, set? How are you going to train this out? Okay, so if we know from science that the horse has this abnormality, right, unevenness, for whatever reason, we need to take care of that. And we do that with orthopedic saddle fitting. Okay. Next thing is pinching the withers. This here is cranial nerve 11. And you see here, you see a nasty line. Some veterinarians call that the pain line. Okay, so if people tell you this is the fit line, they might be out for lunch, or they haven't read the or understand the anatomy of the horse. From that nerve, you see these scribbly little narrow things there. Those cause the cervical nerves. So when you pick up a kitten, or a bear picks up the bear cub, or a dog picks up the puppy, they bite them in the neck. And the bear cub, the dog, or the kitten, they all go slough. So when the stallion bites the kitten, sorry, when the stallion bites the mare or the other stallion, the horse gives up. So why would the stallion bite the mare in the neck? Well, that makes the mare not going forward. Okay? And it drops the neck, boom. So when there's pinching on the withers, it drops the neck. So it starts off with the pain line. And when the neck drops, then the compression between the scapula and the ribs will occur. And it goes all the way down to the foot. So all of a sudden you have a horse where it's lame because that stupid saddle is pinching on the withers. This nerve here, which is between the shoulder blade and the ribs, calls the brachial plexus. Just because your saddle gets pinched. And remember the first picture I showed you? There you go. There is the pain line, and there's all the clear sign that that horse has the pinched shoulder, stuck rib cage. Okay, look at this big dip. That horse, not happy. So is this horse just putting on show so you don't need to ride him? Is this horse heavy in your hand because he doesn't want to, it's just lied to you? Or does he trying to avoid the pain even more and trying to compensate for it? If the horse is happy and doesn't act against your aids, obviously your seat, if it's your leg, if it's a forwardness, they lift the rib cage. And you see here, the distance from the rib cage to the shoulder, where the nerve is on the inside, it's lots of space. So nature has kind of this cool space there. But if the horse ducks down because it tries to avoid the pain in the neck, then that pinches. It's a beautiful medical term written by Edmund in 2016. So if we know all this, and sometimes certain behavior, like here, okay, could be negative or purposely written, depends what sport you like. You know, there's a massive controversy since 2006 about classical dressage and roll cure or hyperextension. Okay, so I only have my small judge's license. So we have been told if a horse shows you a circus trot or show trot, you ring the bell, first warning. If they keep doing it, you eliminate them. Now these days, well, they get tense, right? So this here, the horse is 100% on the forehand, super hollow. And this is a European super champion. Horses behind the vertical. We know all that if you read the F, and that's all stuff what is horrible. But not just in politics or in other industries, there is corruption everywhere. But if we talk about the horse shows you sign, what is this horse shows you, right? What signs are here? Is that horse happy or is just in a position? Yeah, does the curb really needs to be that tight and the mouth is wide open? Okay, so these are signs. This is probably a better sign. These are not happy horses. They don't lie. Something is really hurting. And sometimes I just hold on to dear life to not fall off because the horse runs away. So just to finish my point, when the horse is pitched on the withers, they drop the rib cage, okay? Elbow, shoulder, one line, and then they get pinched on that brachial nerve. Normally there's space, they have no problem. Good riders with good fitting saddles have the ability, he's light in my hand, the rib cage comes up, he lifts, and they jump wonderful. Not like this here, where they get pinched. The horse is trying to get over this. Otherwise, God knows what happens to them. You always see when they get pinched when the feet are together and not beside the rib cage. Okay, so this horse here, beautiful. Look at that. Feet apart, And here the ribcage is lift, piece of cake. Absolutely wonderful. So if we have veterinarian, never mind saddle makers or Olympic riders or the peanut gallery who doesn't like what horse activists like to say, what about people who took an oath, do no harm to horses? Or what about vets? When the veterinarian dissects horses and teaches people, look at this tree, these narrow trees clamped over the horse's withers, how is that shoulder going to go through there? This is now the cartilage, what's underneath the tissue here, that gets damaged. It's very straightforward. So if we see this, what is on YouTube, and we see all this is shown and all this is explained, why? Why are we not reading to the signs? I think this lady explained it the best. Another veterinarian, traveled on 5 different continents, beautiful show jumper, and she's super passionate about horses. Let's listen to her for 3 minutes.
Horse would merely canter and not even lift. He wouldn't, there would be no jump to speak of. And if you look at him now, he's lifting through his shoulders. And one of the most beautiful parts, which you can just make out in the picture at the back here, he is pushing off the ground. And this is a novice horse. And I can't tell people how important and how special this is and how much the saddle has enabled this horse to do this. He has never pushed off the ground like this. Now, the classic way of training show jumpers would be to go back, force him through many, many lines, force him into a pushing position, even if he is uncomfortable, even if his body couldn't do it, even if he was restricted. You would then put him in lines that would force him to push with both back legs. That would have broken my horse. And it does many, many horses, because we're not addressing the thing that is stopping them from pushing. I don't know if anybody's ever watched a horse that is free jumping or actually just in the field jumping by themselves. They have no problem pushing. They only have a problem pushing when we're on their backs and we restrict them with equipment that does not allow them to utilize their thoracic sling, their abdominals, and their back appropriately. There's another point on this picture. There's a reason I picked this particular shot. There are a few better shots where he's got much more elegant technique of lifting his front legs. But this particular picture shows you actually his thoracic sling coming into play. And I'm just going to use my cursor. If you look here, you see his pectoral muscles in its actual groups contracting in order to allow this jump to happen. And that is spectacular. It is very rarely seen. And I think it's underrated, because this allows this horse to lift and not just lift. He's lifting his entire sternum and he's lifting all his shoulders. And the freedom that it's allowed him is remarkable. From this point of view, that I urge everybody to look for this when they're looking at a jumper saddle. If you're looking at a dressage horse's saddle, it's not much different. You want to look for elevation. You know, I listened to a marvelous talk. It was also with Jochen, I think it's a couple of years ago now, but you know, if you watch horses and you watch a stallion trying to impress mares, the one thing they do to impress each other is they come off the ground. They have a moment of suspension. They hang in.
Anyway, I just love listening to her, because this lady truly, truly knows her stuff. Okay, so, and as most scientists, you know, some of them are not writers. Most of them, veterinarians, are writers. They're so passionate. You know, this veterinarian goes out of the way to teach Joe Normal or whoever who wants to learn to how important saddle fitting is. I was so pleased to meet Professor Weishaupt and Wolfgang Meyerhofer and Christian Peham. These gentlemen are so dedicated to get these horses a better life. And yes, there is no magic bullet, right? You need everything from proper shoeing, proper training, proper teeth, proper nutrition, and so on and so forth. But I cannot emphasize enough, you know, when you look how happy this horse looks when he hops over this, hopsing, I like to say. Look at these cute little horses. So when the horse is not tickled or not irritated, start to read their signs. They don't make stuff up. I use this to show, okay, I can manipulate certain trigger points and the horse does something. Okay, he's not happy. Okay, but I use this to show you how much shoulder movement there is, right? So it's important, if imagine she is the saddle and would block that area. Here I have a see-through horse. I just run my phone around it to show you in another angle how much room there actually is between the ribcage and the shoulder. Okay, there should be no reason why we need to squish that. So when the leg goes forward, that scapula rotates upwards, backwards, and comes back. But it doesn't do it just upwards, backwards, and comes back. It also rotates in the figure eight motion on this joint. This is the upper arm here, that's the scapula, just like that. So I urge everybody, listens to the professionals, listens to the people who written article, who understand, no, right? The horses don't lie. They don't make stuff up just because they don't like men or they don't like Mondays or whatever, you know? So Odia has sent me this. I love this. I love this saying, you know, we as horseback riders, as saddle fitters, as horse lovers, we must avoid the pain and damage to these horses with ill-fitting saddles. We have to follow science and not opinion. I love this saying. What does it say here? If you are not a scientist and you disagree with scientists about science, it's actually not disagreement. You're just wrong. Science is not truth. Science is finding the truth. When science changes its opinion, it didn't lie to you. It learned more. So again, these people looking for do no harm to the horses, looking for the new technology, and looking for better understanding how we can make equipment, what we can do new. And with that in mind, hope you listen to your horse more to understand when they look at you like that, what are they really telling you? Horses in the wild lived for millions and millions together and still do. And the body language, it's the number one how they communicate. So learn the body language. If a horse reacts out of the norm because your tack doesn't fit properly, please give us a call. You know, we have a website published right here, right above here of my head. There's lots of books I have written now. I say lots, two was enough for me. But with that, I know that most of you who love horses, the horse will love you bad. So thank you very much for listening. And I can't wait to talk to you again. Talk to you soon. And Mary Claire, thank you for putting this on as usual. So bye for now.